Just last bit of mathematical tools that are convenient for the mathematics we're going to do. Guys, thanks. Okay. So, operators that are based on the covariance derivative. So we have the covariance derivative. I just write it here for convenience. And I use the mu v nu, so that's the covariance derivative for a vector. That's equal to the derivative with respect to nu of our vector, plus, because it's a vector, it would be a one form, we would have a minus here. Now we have a vector, therefore we have a plus. Nu, derivative mu, dummy indices, v gamma. Then we can have the divergence. That is nothing but I use the alpha and V alpha. I can just apply the definition that we have above. Therefore, we have the alpha V alpha plus alpha alpha gamma V gamma. And then we just apply what we've seen before. You see, we have alpha and alpha repeated. In the previous board, you have seen that we have an expression for this sort of contracted, affine connection, for this contracted the Christoffel symbol, which is related to the minus of the determinant. And we can write it in this way. In the notes, you find the steps. Okay? The only step from here to here was just to write explicitly the expression of the Lorentz connection. Sorry, the Lorentz connection with the Christoffel symbols, where the two alphas are repeated up and down, okay? Then we have the gradient that we already know. I just repeat it here so that you have all operators together. So for a scalar, whenever it's the covariance derivative is applied to a scalar, it's like applying the standard derivative. Then we have the Laplacian, in which we have the alpha. Yes, you can write it above, okay? And remember that this is just a way of expressing the scalar product in which the metric is hidden, okay? So I could write it as metric applied to the two covariance derivative, okay? Which is defined as the new box operator, and now it's covariant with respect to, it's covariant in a manifold because it's based now on covariant derivatives. And we can have also let's apply to something, so let's apply it to a scalar. Which is our box operator, and this can also be written as the scalar column phi, column alpha. Okay, you can also find it expressed in this way. Then what we do, we can just apply this expression in which the alphas are repeated. There is some boring and useless mathematics taking place. And in the end, what we get is that if I am tedious enough, you will find it in the exercises, how to derive it. But I don't know if I want to be so cruel. Okay? This is just to let you know that there are ways in which you can have simple, relatively simple expressions for this sort of operator. And the same, of course, you can do similarly, you can do with higher order tensors. But you get quite ugly equations that are not used so often. Another thing that I forgot is the curl. The curl of, a one form, so alpha component alpha beta, remember that the curl is a one form or is a vector. I'm giving you a tensor, so it forgives you a tensor. And it's defined as the alpha, v is a one form, so beta minus the beta v alpha. And then what? You just apply again your expression for the covariance derivative. And we have d alpha v beta minus, because it's a one form, affine connection. Then we have the derivative alpha. We want to get beta. And then the dummy indices are on top. Minus. So now it's I try the flipped indices. So I just repeat the same with the flipped indices. And now look. This guy and this guy is the same, except for the fact that the two indices are flipped. But we are under torsion free. Therefore, the two guys cancel. And we just have that this guy is the standard curl. Okay, many times in GR books, there is the tendency of kind of losing the track of the torsion-free condition. Okay, it's always lurking there. You see, for example, also here several times they just tell you, the curl is just this guy. Yes, but there is an assumption. Okay, which is completely fine in GR. If you're talking about GR, this is implicit. But just keep in mind that torsion free is always there, okay? And it's kind of popping up here and there. Good. Now let's give another look at the fine connection. I just want to give you a slightly different perspective. This would be not necessary because I gave you all the mathematical needs, all the mathematical motivations for which we can and must use a covariant derivative. And I gave you all the mathematics and stuff in which you understand why the covariant derivative looks like it looks. Okay? But I would like to give you yet a little spin, a slightly different perspective to kind of get to better understand what that operator is doing. So this is a little bit dirtier with respect to what we did before, because before was mathematically clean and all the assumptions were in the right position. Gesundheit. And now I'm going to give you to derive the covariant derivative and the affine connection by already taking some assumption, which is something that you find in GR books several times, like Landau-Lipschitz. You start with those assumptions, like for metric compatibility, from the start. Okay, so it's kind of hidden, and you don't realize that there is an assumption there. So to have a visualization of what we are going to talk about, we just take we embed a path in an higher dimensional space. Okay, like what we did with the sphere. You see, with the clean approach before, I didn't need that because the mathematics was speaking clearly. Now, as I said, I'm giving you a graphical representation, something that is kind of more graphical, and we can derive a path that I didn't call, okay, so it has no name, and we can take a position P and a position Q, 2 points on our manifold, and we can set the basis of our tangent space. And let's take just one basis associated to the point P. So. So the basis E for the position P, and then we take another basis for another point of the tangent space at the point Q. You see, the bases are pointing in different directions. Now what we can do is to ask ourselves, what if I take a vector and express it as the first basis that belong to the tangent space P? This other basis belongs to a different vector space. And it can be different with respect to the, well, let's write it like this. T. How do I relate two vectors that belong to two different spaces together? I can't. Because you know that vectors belong to a vector space if you can make a linear combination of them and you get a vector. But what's the meaning if I have a vector belonging to a vector space, a vector belonging to a vector space, and I sum them up together? It doesn't make sense. So the idea is to now express this vector as this basis as the basis in the position P plus some little change. And I say that this guy belongs to the Q position. Can I do it for arbitrary separated space? No, I do it for infinitesimally closed vectors, position. Therefore, my position Q is going to be x mu plus some delta x mu, with our delta x mu that is going to zero. That's why we speak about differential geometry, because we are talking about comparing vectors that are infinite in different vector spaces, but they are infinitesimally close one to each other. And then we, little difference by little difference, we can kind of move from any position we want through infinitesimal steps. Okay? So that's why we talk about differential geometry. And what we do is to take this little variation of the basis E as a tiny variation. So we express in terms of a derivative of our vector. This case is E, the x beta. You see? The tiny variation is expressed by the derivative times the little shift in position, okay? Derivative times shift is the total change. Okay? So the idea is, if I move from one position P to a very infinitesimally close position Q, my bases are changing under my feet. And what I say is that my little change must happen. I can make the sum, this sum, you see, the sum of these two indices must happen in a tangent space. So I need to project these guys infinitesimally closed. And I make the projection on the tangent space of one of the two points, of the points P in this case. I need to project, I have the change which belongs to the other vector TQ, and I project it on the vector space of P, and then I make the sum. And I do it infinitesimally. And then, here there is the magic, I say that this guy must be expressed in this way, as a linear combination of the basis in a tangent space P. So what I'm saying is that the change, when I go from one position to another, the basis is changing with of a tiny bit. And this tiny bit is expressed as a linear combination over a basis. But what is the linear combination over a basis? It's a vector. Therefore, the assumption that this guy is a vector. You see, basis E, linear combination. Okay? And derivative with respect to beta. So this is fixed, this is fixed, this is the index identifying the basis, and this is a linear combination. So this is a coefficient of a linear combination of basis, which is a vector. And we are assuming it to be that. This is another way of basically expressing the metric compatibility. Okay? That's another way to see that. And you will see that once we do that, and now that we understand that I made it graphically clear that when we move from one position to another, the basis is changing, you will see how the covariant derivative pops up. So let's take the derivative of a vector with respect to the mu direction. How can I express the vector? Well, that's a linear combination over a basis. Therefore, I can write it, I use alpha, V alpha E basis alpha. Right? That's just the vector. Now what? We have a product of two things, a derivative of a product, and I just need to use the product rule of derivatives. Therefore, we are going to have the mu v alpha times e alpha plus v alpha the mu e alpha. Now, what we do? Well, we have our assumption. We know that the derivative, that the little change of our basis is a vector and can be expressed in this way. We plug it into here. Therefore, we get the mu v alpha e alpha. So this is untouched, plus the alpha, and then we have our metric compatible assumption, gamma e gamma. Now, what we can do is that here are dummy indices. You see I have a dummy index and dummy index. I'm free to change them. I can relabel them as I want. And what I want is that the gamma becomes an alpha and the way around such that I can group the bases together. So on this side, I'm basically flipping the labels, and I can because they're dummy variables. Okay? Therefore, we group now this guy and this guy together, because once we flip the indices, these are E alpha, I can call them together. And what we get is delta beta V alpha plus what is left, which is this, gamma alpha mu V alpha. I flipped the index, so that's gamma. Okay, it works. It was a vector. Alpha goes on top. Gamma, sorry guys. New gamma. Okay, now it works. And then we have E and alpha. Can you recognize it? We call this guy covariant derivative of the vector alpha. You see, it pops up. And you can say, oh, but why haven't you done that? It's so short. It's much faster than before. Yes, but it's dirty. It's dirty because I started with an assumption on the right, on the very beginning. You would have not seen it if I would have not done all the stuff we did before. Moreover, I had also to make drawings to make you understand what was going on with the basics, and you don't need that. Plus, I introduced another concept, which is parallel transport up there, because I took my basis, I have my line, and in my manifold, I point my basis and I move straight. This is called parallel transport. This is yet another concept that I would have needed here. But it's not necessary. Okay? When you make it clean, it's not necessary. Then you can say, okay, that guy, you say that is the metric compatibility. Right? I told you. You shouldn't trust me. You need to prove it. So let's do it together. And I will show you that that condition, meaning assuming that the little change of a vector when you move infinitesimally is given by a linear combination gamma. Yes, that's it. Okay, and this is equivalent, that's equivalent of this condition. They are equivalent. To see that, I will not do all the steps, but you find them in the script. We basically just compute the covariant derivative of the metric. So we have the metric G mu nu, and I computed the covariance derivative with respect to the another direction, beta. But how is this guy defined? Well, this guy is defined as G E mu E nu. That's the component, right? That's how you express the component once you express a basis system. I repeated this like a mantra that there is always when you see the components, there is a basis set assumed. And covariance derivative of beta. But how else can you write it? Well, this is the scalar product. Therefore, is the scalar product between the two bases. And this guy is a tensor. It has two indices. We know that the covariance matrix is a tensor. So what we do, we have a tensor covariant derivative. And we have seen how to apply covariant derivative to tensors. So we just write the explicit expression. Beta. Minus, because this is a tensor with lower indices, you see? Therefore, we have the minus, like for one forms. And then we have just our usual linear combination. Just copy to spare some time. Nu beta minus E nu E gamma and nu beta and gamma. And then we have this expression. And we have it applied. You see, there is the dummy indices here. We have the dummy index here. We can just plug in our expression into here explicitly. Okay? You do the multiplications. You see that we have something and then several minuses. And by magic, they all cancel out. Here we would just make products, okay? That's super boring, I'm not going to do it. But you understand what we are doing. So we have just the covariant derivative of the metric, which is a tensor, therefore we just express the covariance derivative for a tensor. And we plug in now the metric compatibility written in this way. And you find out that all the terms here cancel out. Tac. Metric compatibility condition. They are equivalent. Okay? I'm not done enough. I want yet to give you another little spin. I promise you that this is the last one. Okay? And what we can see? We can do something that physicists love, which are Taylor expansions. We Taylor expand anything. So we take a vector, okay? And we just make, find a Taylor expansion for this vector once we move from a position x, and we go to a nearly infinitesimally clear position. And again, our change is assumed to be infinitesimal. Okay, so we go from one position to another. So we have can now parameterize our vector that we parallel transport, as I mentioned before, meaning I am a vector leaving my vector space, and I'm moving just in front to myself, like that. Okay? That's the parallel transport. And I ask myself, what is the vector once I parallelly transport it by an infinitesimal bit along some direction? Then we just have our Taylor expansion. We can write equal, because if I include all infinite terms, that's unequal. X minus, I can put a minus, you know, in a Taylor expansion there is a plus, but I can just use the sign I want, because the another minus could be absorbed by my affine connection. beta gamma mu v gamma at the position x by the tiny shift. Plus infinite terms. So now you see this guy is the coefficient of a Taylor expansion at first order. And now I ask you, what do you learn when you just enter physics? You learn the definition of a derivative. Let's use it. I call it already with the big delta, and you understand where we are going. But I just use the standard definition of the derivative with respect to the beta direction of the mu coefficient of a vector. And it's defined as what, the derivative as you learn it in the first year? As the limit for delta x that's going, the beta direction that is going to zero, of the difference between our vector in the new position minus the original position divided by the shift. Right? Isn't it simple? Now let's plug this guy in here. And what do we get? We get the limit for delta x beta going to zero. And then we have v parallel component mu at the position x plus delta x minus the our connection. Let me put it first, the other one. Minus v mu x. So I kept suspend this term that I put at the bottom. Minus the coefficient of beta gamma mu mu and then gamma at the position x. Plus the x. Sorry, guys, but so this is this and this is that. Okay? Minus the guy here. Divided our the shift, the x beta. What is this? Sorry, otherwise it doesn't come out. What is this? This is just the standard derivative, right? The x this is just the standard derivative. What does it mean? That in the end we get the beta v mu plus, now we have the connection, mu beta gamma of v gamma at the position x. See? Isn't this simple? We just have a Taylor expansion because we are asking ourselves if a parallel transport one vector to another position, how it looks like. That's given by our Taylor expansion. I define my derivative as you did in the textbooks of the first year in mathematical analysis. You plug in your Taylor expansion, you keep only the first order, and then you identify the standard derivative plus another term that gives you your covariant derivative. Yes? What does it mean?
It seems like we just add the t, the symbol
I mean, here there is the this guy here is just the assumption of the metric compatibility. You see, I'm carrying, again, I haven't done it from the start because I'm keeping it from, it would be kind of absorbed instantly there. Okay? All right. Yes. Okay. Good. Finish end of the metric compatibility. Okay. Little summary. I just gave you expressions for the operators that you can build up on the covariant derivative. Just some fine expression to use. Remember that when you see that the curl of one form of a vector and so on is equal to, based on the covariant derivative, is equal to the standard one, but only because there is an assumption. Okay? There is an assumption which is torsion-free. Then I gave you a few other ways of looking at the affine connection, and we used parallel transport. I have my basis, and then I move along one path. Okay? And I'm asking myself, what is the relationship between the basis, between in one position, and the infinitesimally close next neighbor? And we basically have an assumption. We are just saying, okay, my basis is like the original one plus a tiny shift that we assume to be given by this expression, which is basically meaning I'm assuming that this little change is a vector. That's the assumption of metric compatibility that is equivalent to the one that we have seen before. Once we just apply it right away, we get it. We just look what is the change of the metric, and we get exactly the same expression that we imposed before. So you see the equivalence between the two. And you see that if we use the metric compatibility, we exactly get the Christoffel symbols and the standard expression for the covariant derivative. Okay? And here we just said, okay, I just apply the standard derivative to the vector expressed in this way, and usually what you have that is this guy in flat space, that's what you have, but now the bases are changing on position, therefore you need to account for the change of the basis. You plug in your metric compatibility, and you end up by identifying the covariance derivative. Then I give you yet another way of looking at it, in which we Taylor expanded the vector as we move to the next neighbor position, and we identified the affine connection with the coefficient at first order of our Taylor expansion. Good. Next time, we are going to deal with parallel transport. There is not much time. I would like to finish 5 minutes earlier, since I've been stealing you 5 minutes before. And I give you just a graphical representation. That we already met, because I already explained you what parallel transport is. But let's give a closer look to that. So if we are in a flat space, let's say we have a x and y coordinate, we define some path. Something like that, the bases are the same all over the places. Okay? It doesn't matter if I'm here or I'm there. The bases are not going to change. That's why we never took care, in special relativity, to speak about tangent space, because anyway, if I move here or there, the bases are not changing, we don't care to be so picky in the definition of our vectors. And if we have a vector that is pointing in some direction, say this one, and I parallelly transport it along this path, the bases are not going to change, and if I go from A to B through many steps, the vector doesn't change, okay? I have my vector, which is pointing, I don't say, in this direction, and I just move along the path, okay? By trying to keep it still. If we are in curved space, so that's flat, again, let's use a visualization with the surface of a sphere in n dimensions. Okay, not bad. Then we get the equator. And we take a vector and we move it in one direction. So we get it like perfectly pointing north. We shift it, and we arrive here. Okay? Then I say, okay, now I start to go along another parallel, and I want to keep it still vertical in front of myself. So now this vector is going to follow this path. Up, it arrives at a certain position, at the pole. I do the same on the other side. You understand that the situation is going to be symmetric. Arrive there, then it arrived in a certain position, then I flip it. I mean, actually, I was holding it horizontally because I was standing on the sphere like that and I was holding it like this, okay? So I arrived in a certain position and then I start to move north orthogonally and I move like that, okay? But when I arrived on top, we have the vector that is pointing this direction. I do the same on the other side, and I arrived at this situation. So parallel transport, gives you a different result for different paths. That's what may create the distinction between a flat space and a curved space. So we are going to describe formally what parallel transport is. So we will write the expression for it. And then we will define special lines, which are called geodesics, which are the lines for free falling, defining free falling objects' paths. Okay? And there we will start to see gravity for real. Okay? So next lecture, we are going to discover the geodesic equation that give us a very strong hint of what gravity is, and we are going to make a connection with Newtonian gravity, so that I can make sort of a parallel to see where the potential of gravity in terms of Newton are hidden into GR, okay? Or can be not hidden, but it can be associated to phenomenologies in GR that are merely given by the curved space in which we live. Good, thank you very much, and see you next time.